And now, ladies and gentlemen, the session is open for question and answers. So anybody have any doubts regarding the topic you were, feel free to ask anything. He's all here to answer you.
Yeah, be brief, 5 minutes and 5 minutes. I hope I didn't exceed my time, right?
You have got 5 more minutes to speak.
No, I want to help the organizers. If you don't have any question, everything is clear or nothing is clear. It's, yeah. Thanks, Vijay. Vijay, another friend, Ajiran Bhaskar is here. Just yesterday, just 30th, we concluded another global summit of Tamil Nadu, Tamil entrepreneurs around the world, and we had 500 delegates from 17 countries. We just concluded. It was great. So we are just back, and Vijay was to speak there. And Kumaravel gave a fabulous, he's coming out with another fantastic product, you know, like what our Swamiji Ramdev did, Patanchali. He want to also make Patanchalize Tamil Nadu, Tamil Nadu cultural product. I think it's going to rock.
One question here.
Yeah, yeah, sure. Oh, it's money.
Awesome speech.
Thank you.
Applause for founder.
Thank you.
Great. Okay. Yeah, I'm RS Mani here from Wob Academy. I have a question. Can you just brief on the part of the education? Education changes what you feel need to be there in India to make India a superpower.
It's a very, very pompous question. Yeah. First of all, I'm not a believer in any superpower. I don't think we need to have any superpower in the world. We need dignified communities, human communities, protected by compassionate nations. I mean, that's how states should become slim and people should become more, you know, powerful, empowered. This is my idea of a state. I don't think states should be too big and too powerful. I mean, people. So that's my view. I think education, first of all, where we fail is culture, character, attitudes. If we cannot keep a public toilet clean, what are we talking about becoming a superpower? If we cannot keep over, I think these basic characters, courtesy and sensitivity to the fellow human beings, that should be the beginning point. Therefore, our education should radically change. Today's road system, competition, a kind of, you know, it has killed the human spirit. It has killed the last 20 years. Probably it created brilliant minds, but it has taken away the soul. It has taken away. That soul has to be brought back to the system. We will definitely someday you will make it happen. Someday we will become a good power, not a super power. We'll become a good power. Bring soul back to education, character, attitudes, particularly courtesy and sympathy and empathy and compassion to everyone. Thank you. And education, you have a lot of scope. See, today, for example, nobody is seeing an opportunity. Everybody is talking about de-addiction. Behavioral addiction is becoming a major problem today. I mean, children are unable to be away from mobile phones and electronic gadgets. You can have every street, you have a de-addiction center, you will mint millions of rupees actually. Parents will bring them. You have an opportunity there. You name it. Kumaravel, natural sort of
children problem, adult problem.
When you talk about education, within education, none of the kind of 20 years, all our huge structures, no, Loyola, you don't need big buildings. The very way you teach, impart education is going to completely change. You may have phenomenal opportunities there. All you need different ways of educating and so on. So education and your university building in Pakari, with all technologies available, I don't know how it's going to evolve, but you have tremendous opportunities here. Thank you, Mani. Yes, you.
In a country where we're having too much of religious polarization, you know, you're dividing people, we are dividing people through religion. How can we depolarize? How can we stop evangelizing our own religion? Because that is kind of, you know, when we try to evangelize our own religion, we're automatically saying that other religion is not as good as us. So how do we solve this problem? I think this problem, if solved, could lead to a lot more democracy, a lot more actual democracies. How do you see it from your side?
Yeah, it's like, you know, I mean, it's not directly connected to entrepreneurship, but nevertheless, since you asked, Santosh, I will answer this one. I was fortunate to come from a family where my father was a Hindu and my mother a Christian. And my own self, I went through agnosticism, atheism, and then finally, actually I joined one political party. Then only I realized how beautiful my church is. My God, I'll run away from this. Well, it was so suffocating. Their rules and hierarchy are terrible. I mean, you cannot be creative on your own stuff like that. I would always say, I mean, take your religion lightly. Take Europe, for example, Renaissance. It is 500 years of an intellectual war where religion has practically become an irrelevant factor. God need not become irrelevant. Spirituality will not and shall not become irrelevant. But religion can become, I mean, irrelevant. Don't prescribe any solutions. Don't prescribe any solution. You make it change. Like, I fiercely resist anyone. But don't also say, I mean, at one point, you have a product, you sell it. If people like it, they will buy it. If they don't like it, they will reject it. So it applies to religion or ideologies, any ideologies. But what you, an enlightened citizen, you should know what is right, what is the line, what is not the line. I would conclude your question with this. When I was a small boy, all my aunties and uncles were Hindus. Only my mother's a small. So I was just climbing up a tamarind tree near my, I come from a village. And I lost my grip and I was actually coming down, some fraction of a second, but I could still hear my mother screaming Jesus and my auntie screaming Muruga, like Lord Muruga, Muruga. And fortunately I caught hold of a branch and I survived. But until today, I don't know who saved me, whether it was Lord Muruga or it was Jesus. But the fact is, my auntie screamed Muruga, mother screamed Jesus, both screamed two different names, but their love, affection, the demand, the request, prayer was the same. That's all important. I mean, they were screaming that nothing should happen to my child. What does it matter? So therefore, today I think there has been an overdose of, I tell my people, I am very irreverent. Being a priest, I can afford to be, being a reverend, I can afford to be an irreverent. I am very irreverent when it comes to religion. Very, very irreverent. No religion is exactly like, I don't think church today is the way being guided as Jesus wanted. In fact, Jesus never wanted to establish a religion at all. He was a reformer. He was a reformer, for that matter, anybody, sorry, I don't want to speak about other religions. I can critique my religion to be politically correct today in the in these circumstances. Therefore, I think, yeah, religion is going to become a huge problem world over, not only today. In fact, I happened to see a confidential report 2 years before from my good friend, a French diplomat. He was showing a very, very top-level confidential Christian terrorism will arrive in 2027. This is what they said. You see? So, it's no more, and it will be against the gay community, or, you know, it's not against another religion, maybe whom they see as extreme liberal groups. So, he was showing a report. Was quite stunned, zapped myself. So, I don't know where we are heading. It's all up to us. It's all up to us. Take a call. Yes. The last question, I think 1 minute. Yes.
Father,
Santosh. Oh. Yeah.
This question is generally from public's perspective, because whenever we engage from all of us, so, but considering somebody who wants to start a business, college person, because I know a couple of college kids here who have come here to just to get motivated to start up. Or corporate level 3-4 years in the tanga, they want to quit and jump into business. Capital idea. How do you expect them to, you know, overcome that? That's your perspective.
Yeah, I think that's
good business.
Yeah, fear of failure. And when you fail, there is nobody to handhold you and support you and help you to. That's where I mean, first, in the Mar ecosystem, this kind of ecosystem, elevate yourself to spirituality, I always say. Elevate yourself to spirituality, that none of my friends should fail. That's it. You will go to heaven. I say you will definitely really go to heaven. You say none of my friends should fail. If somebody has failed, hold hands. We are one of them. In 1972, in Tamil Nadu, like Jews or the Marwadi community, Chettiar's community, they were controlling the financial, you know, this one. But then with the nationalization of banks and all things, beautifully handled Western Tamil Nadu. If anybody is from Western Tamil Nadu, of course, community-based. You can have all critiques, but yeah, I see a positive coming together of sometimes communities. The Western Tamil Nadu, there was a community support system. If I can be very precise, the Kongu Vilala community of that region, they didn't charge, you know, unusually high interest rates, and they were also encouraging young people to succeed, where they converted the community identity into a proactive, caring capital distribution arrangement. I mean, they have succeeded. Today, the way they have in the last 30 years, with also the political support they have received from, they have really gone ahead. They have gone very high. A similar arrangement never happened in the southern Tamil Nadu. So, you mostly hear about all these, you know, meter vatti, blade vatti, all the stuff, more in that part of the. So, that dimension of your community, hand-holding, making capital available, all those things. I'm just quoting one example where there was this hand-holding community arrangement, they prospered. Look at the way Western Tamil Nadu has prospered. It's phenomenally prospered. And look at the way Southern Tamil Nadu is still struggling with all these many problems and difficulties. Just one. Anal neenga be enlightened, handhold each other, success of let's say success of Kumaraveli, success of Santosh. Success of Santosh is Father Jegath Gaspar's Santosh. When you naaliki vandu neenga or BMW vote poninga romba santosh padruvanga. I'll be very, very happy if I see you driving a BMW. But because you gained wealth, you go on BMW, next day an Audi, and one house in Murti, another house in Shimla, another house, and I say it's vulgar. Thank you.